Good morning, St. Luke. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Every praise is to our God. Every praise.
All praises be. Good morning, St. Luke. I said, good morning, St. Luke. How many of you came to praise the Lord on this morning? If you came to praise the Lord on this morning, give the Lord a hand clap of praise in this building. Let's glorify our God in this building. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I have been given the privilege to join us and welcome us into our call of celebration. So will you please join me for the call of celebration found in your worship guide. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Lord, as we begin this new journey, unite our hearts, fill us with your spirit, that we will boldly step out to do your will in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Will you please at this time turn in your hymnal to the Spirit Song, UMH 347.
Good morning, St. Luke. If you will follow along with the hymn the first time, the choir's gonna sing the first verse and the chorus for you. And then the second time, you'll join us in on the first verse again.
Thank you.
continuing your guide, please join me for the affirmation of faith. Do you believe in God?
I believe in God Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God and will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Higher,
the rock.
We praise you today, Lord.
Higher, the rock.
Good morning, St. Luke. I am Bernice J. Washington. And I am hyena happy and peacock proud to stand before you this morning, because it is a great day. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you'll notice it's a little warm in here today, and we asked our sexes by design to have it that way. Because where you are going in your future, you're going to be in some uncomfortable positions. So we're just trying to prep you right now for what is to come. And God stepped over to the edge of the world, and he spat out the seven seas. He batted his eyes and the lightning flashed. He clapped his hands and the thunder rolled. And the water above the earth came down. The cooling waters came down. And then God raised his arm and he waved his hands over the seas and over the lands and said, bring forth, bring forth. And quicker than God could drop his hands, fish and fowls, beasts and birds swam the rivers and the seas, roamed the forests and the woods, and split the air with their wings. And God said, that's good. St. Luke, on this day, we await the creation of our brand new future. And we are ready to chart our course to our manifest destiny under the leadership of Reverend Dr. Michale Bowie, Jr. Our fervent prayer is that Dr. Bowie will have the wisdom of Samson, the strength of Solomon, the patience of Job, and the commitment of David. For there are still some Goliaths yet to be slain. Armed with a solid education, he will help us to carve a tunnel of hope through the dark mountains of despair and disappointment. Dr. Bowie is an individual who has experienced the thrill of victory, but he's also tasted the agony of defeat. He holds a doctorate of ministry from United Theological Seminary, with an emphasis in church administration and congregational development. He holds a Master of Divinity from St. Paul's School of Theology, where he graduated cum laude, and that simply means he a smart brother. He also holds a Bachelor's of Art from Texas Southern University in Political Science. So he know us. His clerical experiences include lead pastor at Stony Brook United Methodist Church in Ghana, Ohio, a teaching pastor at Jenningsburg United Methodist Church in Tip City, Ohio, and senior pastor at Love United Methodist Church. Horned with all of this education and leadership abilities, he brought with him to St. Luke his top gun. And that is his wife, Jeanette. And you see, ladies and gentlemen, he affectionately calls her his baby. For nearly two decades now, they read the fine print in those wedding vows that said, for better or worse, for richer or for poor, and they still said, I do. When Pastor Bowie saw Jeanette, he simply rolled up to her and said, girl, you are real brick house. You make an old man wish for younger days. And with that, they became one. But he is not a gentleman who will ask for lighter burdens. He is a man who will pray for a stronger back. He is a bold, raising, bodacious man of color who knows exactly who he is, from whence he has come, and has a guideline to where he's trying to go. On this 4th of July weekend, you got to remember that there stands in the harbors of New York City a Statue of Liberty holding high a flaming torch that symbolizes hope and possibilities. The hope that each one of us can pursue and achieve our own individual American dreams. So it really doesn't matter whether your ancestors came over here on the Mayflower or on a slave ship. We are all in the same boat together now. So either we're gonna stand together or we are destined to fall apart. Dr. Bowie takes the helm of this battleship as we set course to explore frontiers unknown. From this day forward, Dr. Bowie is our flag bearer. And St. Luke, we will not let that flag fall. Where he leads, we will follow. Our sincere prayer is that God will saute him in his mercy, marinate him in his love, sprinkle him with goodness, simmer him in wisdom, and when he's well done, add a dash of humility. Dr. Bowie, would you be kind enough? Dr. Bowie, we present ourselves to you this day as an empty vessel, and we ask you to fill us with the glory of goodness that God can grant us. From this day forward, in your hands, we commit our future. May the good Lord take a liking to you.
With those wonderful, wonderful words of introduction, let us all participate in the order for the celebration of an appointment that's printed in your worship guide. May we stand? Dear friends, today we welcome our senior pastor, Dr. Michael Bowie. We also welcome our associate pastors, Elsie Oldham Jr. and Sandy Miner, who have been appointed to serve along with our senior pastor. We believe that they are well qualified and have been prayerfully appointed by Bishop Michael McKee. Pastor Bowie, Oldham, and Miner, you have been sent to live among us as bearers of the Word of God, as ministers of the sacraments, and as sustainers of the love, order, and discipleship of the people of God.
So today we affirm this commitment in the presence of this congregation.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, as a people committed to participate in the ministries of the church by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service, will you who celebrate this new beginning support and uphold Senior Pastor Bowie and Pastors Oldham and Miner in these ministries? How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of the messenger. Let us pray together. Eternal God, strengthen and sustain us in our ministries together with Pastors Bowie, Oldham, and Miner as our spiritual leaders. Give them and us patience, courage, and wisdom to care for one another and challenge one another, that together we may follow Jesus Christ, living together in love
and offering our gifts and talents in your service,
through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. 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 It's all right, give God some praise for our leadership. Amen. And now we come to a very important part of our worship celebration. And especially on this day as we begin a new chapter in our wonderful history, we'd like to pause to welcome those who may be visiting with us here at St. Luke. And so if this is your first time in this church, or the first time in a long time, won't you please stand that we might recognize you? Remain standing, won't you? Remain standing, if you will. On behalf of our senior pastor, Dr. Michale Bowie, and all the ministerial staff of St. Luke, I would just like to say welcome to you. We are just delighted that of all the places you could have been this day, you chose to worship here with us. And in anticipation of your arrival, we wrote a song that is especially for you. And the words to that song are, welcome to St. Luke, where Jesus is Lord. Welcome to St. Luke, where we are into God's word. We are a church that reaches up to God, and we are a church that reaches out to everyone. Welcome, welcome, welcome to St. Luke. And now, St. Luke members, won't you stand and help me greet our visitors? If you will do the St. Luke shuffle. Move a little closer to your neighbor, because we have even more who are trying to join us in worship. Amen. And I would just say again to those who are visiting with us, welcome. We are truly glad that you are here. And if perchance you are in the church shopping business or looking for a church home, please know that we would love to be your church. Amen? We would love to be your church. And in your worship guide, there is a list of all the ways that you can become affiliated with St. Luke Community United Methodist Church. And at the conclusion of the gospel message, an invitation will be given and chairs will be placed in front of the altar. And that is your cue, if God is speaking to your heart, to come on down. We would love to be your church. And we like to say, the price is right, because Jesus paid it all. Amen? Amen. And now, I'd just like to have a special word of welcome for one other special group of people here today. Would all those people, members, friends, guests, who were born in the month of July, please stand that we can recognize you. Hey.
Happy birthday to you. St. Luke, how are you feeling about now? The Lord has been good, amen? Some of you have been knocking at the gates of heaven for a long time, and this morning you see the manifestation of God's answer to your prayers. It's prayer time. If you want, you can make your way down to the altar. If you'd rather just sit at your seat, make an altar right there as unto the Lord, amen? The pastors will come down and just give you a touch to remind you that Jesus is truly the true and living God and that he will touch you. Lord is going to move in a mighty way, and we pray that you will just catch the power of the Spirit and just go with him. Amen? Amen. Amen. If you want to come from the balcony, you are welcome. If you need healing this morning, make your way down to the altar. If there are some things going on and you just need to know that Jesus cares, I ask you to make your way down to the altar. Amen. Amen. Let us prepare our hearts now, our minds. Where it says where two or more gathered, the Lord is in the midst. And I truly believe he is in the midst this morning. Let us pray. Oh, merciful God, this morning we bow down before you in humble submission to your Spirit, Lord. We bow before you this morning because you said we could come to you when we had a need, Lord. We could come to the foot of the throne, Lord, and just make our appeals to you. And we say thank you for that opportunity. And so out of obedience to your word and your Spirit, we come this morning. We come with praise and thanksgiving, for you have been a God that has brought us a mighty long way. And for that, we say thank you. You've been a God that has brought us through dangers seen and unseen. And for that, we say thank you. You've been a God that's been with us on the rough storms, the waves of the sea, Lord, when they had us just tossing and turning. And Lord, you came and spoke to the winds and the waves in our lives, and peace, Lord, began to reign, and for that we say thank you. Lord, but we would be remiss if we didn't acknowledge, Lord, that all the time we haven't done what we needed to do. And so right now, in the precious name of Jesus, Lord, we take time to acknowledge that we have sinned and fallen short, and we need your forgiveness. Oh, God, forgive us, and then, Lord, not only forgive us, cleanse us from all unrighteousness, make us worthy of your living care, then, God, lift us up, turn us around, do what whatever needs to be done, that we can go forth, Lord God, declaring that there is a true and living God who cares about his people. Lord, we thank you, Lord, as we gather in this place this morning, and we have come for so many different reasons, but one thing we can all acknowledge is that Jesus, hallelujah, is the center of our joy. Jesus is the center of the fellowship. Jesus is the center of everything that's going on. It is by your grace and mercy and your love that we could even gather in this place. And so we acknowledge, Lord, that it isn't us, but it's you working through us. And we give you praise for that this morning. Now, Lord, for all of those who have gathered at the altar, you know the things of the heart. You know the things of the soul. You know the trials, the tribulations, Lord. You know things that are going on, the chaos, Lord. Hallelujah. We ask you now to speak. Hallelujah. Peace to the hearts and minds of those who come. Let healing flow in this place, Lord, like rivers of water, that those that had a little problem walking might find themselves with a little pep in their steps. That those, Lord God, that have a a problem with seeing, Lord, and things just weren't as clear as they should have been, that they'll leave from here with a vision, a physical vision and a spiritual vision, a 2020 vision, Lord, that lets them see what you want them to see. We thank you, Lord, that you're reaching out and you're touching us and you're guiding us. And Lord, let us not be so mean and stubborn in our own ways that we settle back and become backsliders, but let us come with yielded hearts and minds and spirits, hallelujah, that your will might be done. And then, oh God, you have sent us a new shepherd, hallelujah. One, Lord, that is going to take us right down to the Red Sea and part the waters because you've given him power, hallelujah, over the things, Lord, that would come and mess with us. He's going to part the waters. He's going to lead us down and then lead us up, Lord God, and we choose to follow that your blessed will be done in this place. And now, Holy Spirit, wind that the Spirit blow from the north, east, south, and west, fill this place as only you can. Fill our hearts, Lord. Fill our spirits, Lord. And let us find our refuge and joy in you. It's in the precious name of Jesus that we offer our prayers. And all the saints of God said, amen, amen, and amen.
God say amen. God is speaking to our hearts this morning. God is moving as we pray to God, and I hear God saying, cry out to me and I'll show you great and mighty things you don't even know. Nudge your neighbor, say it's time for the offering. If you're excited, give God some praise. I hear God say, get excited. I love a cheerful giver. How many of y'all are cheerful givers this morning? How many realize that had not been for God on your side, you wouldn't be here this morning? So let's give our God a great big round of applause in this place this morning. Giving is a spiritual act of worship. And I heard somebody say, you can't be God giving no matter how hard you try. So we have some words on how we're going to give. So come on up here, Doc.
Let us unite our hearts by sharing together the scripture for giving, which is printed in your worship guide. From Mark 4th chapter, the 24th verse. Consider carefully what you hear, he continued. With the measure you use, it will be measured to you, and even more. Let us pray. Oh God, let us, as we prepare to use our measure, just be reminded for just a quick moment of the measure you have already used with each and every one of us. Let us be reminded of how you've blessed us, how you've kept us, and provided for us in the days leading to this one, as we now prepare to give to you of that which you have given to us. In Jesus' name, amen. May the ushers come. There will be two sets of trays that will come amongst you. The first set, the silver set, are for the gifts that we will use to bless the community through our social service activities. We want to be a church that is a blessing to others, knowing that all of us have times when we're low, and we want to be able to reach out in God's name to lift those up. And the second set of trays, the gold trays, are for our tithes and offerings that enable us to continue the many ministries of this church. And we invite you to give. Also, as the offering continues, in the back of each pew, there is a black binder in which we'd like for you to register your attendance. We are indeed delighted that you are here, and we want to be sure that our records reflect accurately your current address, that we might be in touch with you. So won't you please register your attendance as the offering continues? And then I would also share with you just two brief announcements. Number one, today we were blessed as we welcomed our new pastor and our new pastoral staff to worship in unity at 10 o'clock. But on next Sunday, we will again have two worship opportunities at 8 and 11. So beginning next Sunday, we're back to 8 a.m. and 11. Amen? Amen. Number two, Pastor Bowie has already begun making plans for some wonderful new worship experiences. And beginning this week, on Wednesday night, the chapel will be open for prayer as always. But we won't be in a formal service as we have been. We'll have continuing prayer in the chapel, but we're beginning to plan under Pastor Bowie's leadership for a new Wednesday night experience. That's just a teaser. You'll get more details as it goes forward. Amen? All right. Amen.
The Lord does indeed continue to bless us. Amen. One more time. God has given us an opportunity to gather in this God's house and to celebrate that most holy and sacred meal that our Lord Jesus prepared for us 2,000 years ago. So if you would please turn with me in your order of worship to the sacrament of Holy Communion. Now, it is important to note that we in the United Methodist Church, we practice what is known as an open communion table. You see, what we believe is that the Lord's Supper is exactly what it says. It is the Lord's Supper. It doesn't belong to any particular church or denomination. It belongs only to God. And as such, only God can determine who can and cannot come. And so we here at St. Luke practice an open table so that all are invited to participate in this holy meal. First, let us confess our sins. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. And free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Beloved, in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory be to God. And so the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. And so, it is with your people here on earth and with all the company of heaven that we praise your name and we join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. And so it is in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, that we offer ourselves in praise and in thanksgiving. As a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of our faith, that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. All glory and all honor is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever.
When Jesus gathered his friends around the table, they were people like you and me, ordinary people, but he had a great work for them. And they had questions about their faith. And they said, Lord, how will we know where to go? And he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And I will give you a remembrance through my body. And he looked at them and he said, always remember that this is my body, broken just for you. Take and eat as often as you will, knowing that I was broken, that you might experience wholeness in every area of your life. This is Christ's body broken for you. The good news about Jesus, he never starts anything that he doesn't finish. And he said, this is my cup. Cup poured out for the forgiveness of sins. That in this cup, there's a new vision. The old has passed away, and behold, all things are new. In this cup, there's forgiveness. In this cup, there's no condemnation. In this cup, sin has been swallowed up because of my sacrifice, your shedding of my blood. What can wash away our sins? He told them, nothing but my blood. The blood of Christ shed just for you. Take and drink. Let us pray. God, pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts, on these sacrificial elements. Let them be reminded to us today that this is your body and this is your blood, that we might be your representations in the world, to be your hands and feet, to give hope, help, and healing to those who need you the most. Pour out your Holy Spirit. Let us use these gifts of the sacraments to make a difference, not only in this church, but in the world. And it's in Jesus' name we pray, and we all say together, amen.
On your electronic device. Somebody say amen. Let us find the book of Nehemiah, chapter 1. Nehemiah, chapter 1. We're going to read verses 1 through 6 and then verse number 11. Amen. Let us, those who are able, stand in honor of the reading of God's word. Now, if you haven't found it yet, say, hold up. Amen. Nehemiah, chapter 1, verses 1 through 6, and then verse number 11. And so now let us listen for a word from the Lord as I read from the New International Version. The words of Nehemiah, son of Hakala, in the month of Kislev, in the 20th year, while I was in the citadel of Susa, Hanani, one of my brothers, came from Judah with some other men. And I questioned them about the Jewish remnant that survived the exile, also about Jerusalem. And they said to me, those who survived the exile and are back in the province are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates have been burned with fire. When I heard these things, I sat down and wept. For some days, I mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. And then I said, O Lord, God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and obey his commands. Let your ear be attentive to and your eyes open to hear the prayer your servant is praying before you day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's house, have committed against you. And now verse 11. O Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of this your servant and to the prayer of your servants who delight in revering your name. Give your servant success today by granting him favor in the presence of this man. For I was cupbearer to the king. This is the word of God for the people of God. Yes, we are thankful for God's word. Please be seated.
I don't know about you, but I can sense the presence of the Lord in this house. How many of y'all feel the presence of God? And wherever God is, that's where I want to be. Even the valley, God says, I'm there. Even in that mountain, God says, I am there. If you want God to bless you, stand on your feet. Let's just tell God, bless us one more time. Hallelujah. Bless us, God. Bless us indeed, God. The presence of the Lord is here right now. God is here right now. He's here to break yokes. He's here to give you a new day of victory. God is here right now. Seated if you can. Every now and then you have to just soak stuff up, all right? We'll never have this day again. But somebody said, today is the first day of the best days of the rest of our lives. I want y'all to embrace this moment. Let's give our great God a great big round of applause in this place. God is in this room right now. When two or three are gathered, God said, I'll be in the midst. So God is here right now, and there is a word from the Lord. I'm excited to be here this morning, and it is great being with you in worship today, and I just want to thank all of our guests. We have guests in overflow. We have a packed house this morning. I want to thank all of our guests who've driven from far and near. Let's give all of our guests a great big round of applause this morning. I want to thank my family who's driven from Houston and Beaumont all around the great state of Texas. Family, my biological family, stand up, my biological family, if you can, show them some love. Where's my, all right, yeah, and I have my friends who are my family, and I got some friends who drove all the way from Houston, so my friends drove, if you drove from Houston or around the country, stand up and show my friends some love right here. These are my family. I want to say to my son, Trey, he's Michael III, and to my daughter, Lauren, she's in Singapore. I just want to thank God for my kids who've been so resilient. They are PKs, pastor kids, TOs, theological offsprings. They have been, but they've been resilient, none other. And I thank God for my kids. So show some love to Trey and Lauren. And I was thinking, I'm going to save the best for last, but I have some brothers who are, they're taller than me. I'm smarter than them. But I love them. They're older than me. And so we have Pastor Junius Dotson from St. Mark United Methodist Church in Wichita. Keep standing. And we have Dr. Kevis Harding from Delrose United Methodist Church in Wichita, Kansas. And we have Pastor Ed Jones from the Living Water Church in Pearland, Texas. Now, these are my three amigos. And so if the sermon goes well, give me credit. If it goes bad, talk to them, all right? But these are my brothers. I love them. Thank you all for being here. Thank you for praying. Show some love to these pastors who are making a kingdom difference in United Methodism. And I said I was going to say the best for last. I want to just thank my baby. Jeanette, she's my girlfriend on Fridays. We have date night, all right? Make sure you have date night. And she's my baby's mother 7 days of the week. She's my soulmate. She's my better half, and I love her so much. Y'all show some love to Jeanette Elaine Bowie. Thank you, Jeanette, for your constant care. Thank you for your constant care, for your consistent prayer, and for your commitment to loving me for over 18 years. As I said last night, I'm reminded of a song I think Sam Cooke said. It's been a long time, but y'all don't get so holy on me. A change gonna come. And for the young folks, Jeanette, think about it. We started from the bottom, now we are a multi-generational community, all right? Yeah, it's so good to see my baby in front of me, and it's good to see you all right here. And I said you all, and I've been in Ohio for about 10 years now, and it's been a y'all. So it's good to see y'all this morning, all right? I remember my family from Ginsburg, and it's so good seeing y'all here in Texas. So it's good seeing y'all here. And to St. Luke family, to the entire leadership team, I want to thank you for all you've done for me and my family, to help my family throughout this tedious process. Sister Washington, the entire leadership team, you have been so excellent in your commitment to detail. Your hospitality has been par excellent, and your incredible support has been so good for us as we transition through this tedious journey. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. So do me a favor, St. Luke family, you have been so faithful. You've been patient, and you've been committed. You've weathered many storms. But by the grace of God, by saying yes to Jesus and holding on, realizing that God was going to bless this church indeed. So do me a favor, everybody, give St. Luke Church a great big round of applause. Give yourself a great big round of applause. You have achieved such an enormous task. You've taken something that's been hard. You've transitioned us from Ohio to Texas, and that wasn't easy, amen? But in spite of the challenges and difficulties, you stepped up. And you made it happen. Thank you for trusting God. Thank you for being obedient to this new season at St. Luke. And I tell you, you have stepped up in a tremendous way. And I tell you, God is pleased. And as I think about how you stepped up and undertaken this enormous task, I'm reminded of a man named Nehemiah. Nehemiah also faced an enormous task. Nehemiah didn't have the task of leading a family from Ohio to Texas, but he had a greater task than that, amen? Nehemiah was responsible for restoring, for renewing, and for rebuilding a generation of people who had been in Babylonian exile for over 70 years. Nehemiah had a daunting task. Nehemiah was called by God to allow the Israelites to turn their hearts back to Yahweh, the God of Israel, after they had forgotten about their first love. Nehemiah had a task. Nehemiah's job was to allow this once powerful and prestigious and prominent nation to get back to its place where God had first called them. Nehemiah had a job to do. Say he had a job to do. But there were some requirements and expectations to be accomplished before this could become reality. Pastor Odom read this passage, but I want to just read it again just for you here in Nehemiah 1. You don't have to stand up. Just hear these words once again. The word of Nehemiah, son of Hakaliah, in the month of Kislev, in the 20th year, while I was at the city of Susa, Hananiah, one of my brothers, came from Judah with some other men. And while I questioned about the Jewish remnant who had survived the exile and also about Jerusalem, they said to me, "Those who survived the exile are back in the providence, but are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates have been burned with fire." When I heard these things, I sat down and wept for some days. I mourned, fasted, and prayed before the God of heaven. And then I said, Lord, the God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keeps his commandments. Let your ear be attentive and let your eyes be open to hear the prayer of your servant is praying before you day and night for the servants of your people of Israel. I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's families, have committed against you. Verse 11 says, Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of this your servant and to the prayer of your servants who delight in revering your name. Give your servant success this day by granting him favor in the presence of this man. For I was the cupbearer to the king. I want to just tag this teaching moment for a few minutes, and I want to just title it, Discover a New Vision. Turn to your neighbor. Your neighbor's the person sitting next to you. Look him in the eye and says, neighbor, oh neighbor, say it's time to discover a new vision. Now that neighbor didn't smile. Turn to another neighbor and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, are you ready to discover a new vision? Give God some praise. Be ready to discover a new vision. Talking about discovering a new vision. Let's go to God in prayer. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this day. We praise you, for you have already blessed this house. So God, speak through me in spite of me. Get me out of the way, oh God. Have your way in this place. Unclog ears, soften hearts. Get flesh out of the way. Speak to our hearts, oh God. Do what you do best, God. You heal, you deliver, but most of all, you save. Get me out of the way, oh God. Rescue me from me, that these your people will hear not me, but you. Spirit of the living God, have your way. And it's in Jesus' name we pray, and we all say together, amen. Talking about discover a new vision. Well, I hear somebody in the balcony saying, well, what is a vision, Dr. Bowie? I'm glad you asked. Vision, according to Webster's Dictionary, is the ability to see and to possess sight. Vision is a thought or a concept that is formed in one's mind or vivid imagination. Vision is that promising picture that God has for your preferred future. Vision. Anybody who's done anything great for God has had to have a vision. Say vision. Vision. When Dr. King saw all the inequality and injustice that saturated America, he had a dream or a vision. He had a picture of a better nation. When Harriet Tubman successfully escaped the tyranny of slavery, she didn't get comfortable, but she had a vision or a picture called the Underground Railroad to help others get set free as well. John Adams had a vision of a nation being independent and separated from Great Britain. And because of this picture, the United States of America was birthed on July 4th, 1776. Amazing things happen when you have vision. Say, there's power with vision. Helen Keller once said, she says, it's a terrible thing to live with sight and have no vision. And I believe many of us in this room right now, we need a new vision for our family. Many of us, we need a new vision for our finances. Many of us, we need a new vision for our career. And I would even dare say, we need a new vision for our congregation. Say, we need vision. As we step out on faith and take a risk, we must be willing to go where we've never gone before. And then and only then can we discover this new vision or preferred picture for our future. Say, we need vision. Nehemiah knew the importance of vision. He possessed the vision, and he heard the painful predicament that inundated Israel, and he wept profusely, and he felt compelled to do something. I've discovered people of vision don't just sit around and talk about what should happen, but people of vision step out of their comfort zones and make it happen. Say, make it happen. See, we need people of vision who just don't talk about it, but they step out and they are about it. Can I get a witness up in this place?
See, I've realized when you are attempting to discover a new vision, the text teaches us expect to encounter problems. Now, we have a lot of educated folk in it, so many of y'all, you like writing. So there are some places on this bulletin to write because it's going to be some good stuff. Not because I'm saying it, because the Holy Ghost is teaching this. In order to discover a new vision, expect to encounter problems. Nehemiah realized that sometimes life can be going so well, but that didn't exempt him from encountering problems. Nehemiah had a job as a cupbearer. He had a luxurious and a lavish job. His responsibility was to taste the king's drink and his food, making sure he wasn't poisoned. Nehemiah had a great job. He was living a life of luxurious. He was living a life of lavish. He was living a life of plush and peace. But in the midst of this pleasurable, peaceful lifestyle, he gets some problematic news from his brothers that Israel was destroyed and the city lied in ruins. Isn't it amazing, church, how sometimes life can seem to be going so perfect one minute, but the next minute life seems to fall apart to pieces? Am I talking to the right people? Sometimes life seems to be going so well, but you can get some news that will change your whole world. Have you ever received some news that rocked your world before? Have you ever got some news that changed your life? Maybe it was an unexpected layoff. Maybe it was an untimely divorce. Maybe it was that news of that terminal diagnosis. Maybe it was the news of a death of a loved one. We've all received news that has shocked and changed our world. But I've discovered sometimes you can receive problematic news that may come at you even when your life seems to be pleasurable. But I've discovered in my 20-something years of following Jesus that whenever you follow Jesus, you are not exempted from encountering problems. As a matter of fact, Jesus reminded us in John 16 and 33, he says, in this life, he didn't say in the next life. He said, if you follow me in this life, say this life. In this life, you will encounter problems, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world, all right? Well, what is he saying, Pastor Bowie? I'm glad you asked. Jesus is simply saying this. He said, every problem you encounter, I have given you the power to overcome it, and it gets even better. I will use that problem to help you fulfill your preferred picture for your life. Let me get back to this pulpit because it's first Sunday. It's so important. If you follow Jesus, let me chill. Kids say, now, Pastor, turn up. No, I'm going to turn down, all right? Because I realize whenever you follow Jesus, expect to encounter problems. Yeah. See, problems are just an indication, church, that big possibilities are coming. Yes. Yes. Yeah. So, some of y'all catch that at lunch. If you aren't having any problems, you aren't in a position to experience God's great possibilities. It's so important to understand that whenever you follow Jesus, you will encounter problems. I can relate to this because 2008, my life was going good. My sisters and brother remember when we were at Gingersburg Church in Tip City, Ohio, 16 miles out of Dayton, Ohio. Life was going good. And out of nowhere, in a staff meeting, I realized that I passed out and I was diagnosed with a baseball-sized tumor. I didn't get this off the internet. I'm talking about what the problem I've gone through. Baseball-sized tumor on the right side of my brain. And in the carnal state, I could say, God, why me? Life is going good. I'm in the best shape of my life, in my opinion. I'm in the best shape of my life. Life is going good. God, I didn't say why. But I realize sometimes God will allow the rain on the just and the... I'm glad you read your Bible. God says, if you follow me, you will encounter problems. Now, what I realized early on in my life, I realized that I could have given up. I could have thrown in the towel. But God says, I gave you the biggest burden in your head, not because you got a big head, but I got big things for you. I'm going to give you the biggest burden because you can have the biggest blessing. So I stop by to tell you, as I follow Jesus on my journey here at St. Luke, you have to have some big problems in order to get to your big preferred picture that God has for your life. I double dog day to give God some praise for the problems that you're dealing with right now. Whenever you're seeking to discover a new vision, not only should you expect to encounter problems, but you must exercise constant prayer. The text teaches us in the midst of encountering problems, Nehemiah didn't complain like those folk at the church down the street do. You know, we don't do that at St. Luke, do we? We praise God. We love God with our heart. We don't complain about nothing, do we, choir? But Nehemiah, he didn't complain, but he went before God and he prayed. Say he prayed. Nehemiah was a man of prayer, and he communicated with God, and he expected great results from God. When people of vision pray, they attempt to go to the throne of God. And they know when they go to God, God will answer in God's time because they expect big things from God. Say big things. When people of vision attempt to do great things, they realize the importance of prayer. John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, he believed in the power of prayer. As a matter of fact, Wesley says that prayer is where the action begins. Yeah. Yes. He didn't say your bank account is where the action begins. He didn't say your education. He said prayer is where the action begins. Now, there was a threefold approach to Nehemiah's prayer. He knew where action came from. The first thing, I'm going to get out of your way. The first thing, when he prayed, he began to praise God. You got to write this down. This is some good stuff. You can talk to your folks in the cubicle tomorrow. When he prayed, there was the first level was praise. Say praise. Verse 5, he says, Lord, the God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his commandments. Nehemiah praised God for his superiority. He praised God for his strength. He praised God for his sovereignty. And he praised God for his sincerity. That's the first level of his prayer where action began to happen. So Nehemiah is telling us this morning, St. Luke, that before we ask God for anything, we need to praise and thank God simply for who God is. Sometimes many of us, I'm going to say us, not the folk around the corner, many of us, we fall short of God's best because we focus on our needs first and then we ask God to bless it. I hope y'all have me back next Sunday. We focus on our needs and we say, God, bless this mess. But you must first praise and thank God first, and God said, then I might bless you. His first level was praise. I said I was going to chill. But when I think about all that God's done, I want to just praise him in the noonday and praise him all day long. Somebody give God some praise this morning. Don't get too edumacated. Give God some praise. You know you started from the bottom eating mayonnaise sandwiches, but now you own a business. Praise God. And not only did he praise God, but his prayer had some persistence. Say persistence. Verse 5 says, and I didn't make them, it's all in the text. Look at it in your devotion. Verse 5 says, he prayed day and night. Say day and night. He prayed day and night before God. Nehemiah was so persistent because there was a burden birth from the people of God. And he says, God, I'm going to pray. I'm not going to stop until I get an answer. Have you ever prayed persistently before because you needed an answer from God? Now I'm going to talk to the folk in the back because y'all sleep up there. Have you ever had to pray from God and say, God, if you move, I'm going to fall? Have you ever had to pray to God at 11:59:59 when your money was funny and your change was strange, but God stepped right in? You got to be persistent. And so many of us in this room, we don't get answers from God because we do those drive-by or hit-or-miss prayers. You know how you do it. You put your stuff and you say, God, I need you to move on my timetable. But the last time I checked, God didn't operate through chronos, but God operates through kairos. Say kairos. God said, it's not your way. This ain't Burger King. For the folks watching on TV, you can't have it your way. But you must be persistent and wait on the Lord. Now see, prayer is a two-way street, and some of y'all got it twisted. God didn't answer my prayer. No, it ain't all on God. It's a two-way street. See, when God asks us to do something, when you ask God to do something, there must be some follow through. This is where we miss the mark. You asking God to do all this stuff, and God can. But God says, I want to see what you're working with. God says, this is a two-way street. Matter of fact, Martin Luther said it better than Doc Bullock said. He says, we must pray like it depends on God and work like it depends on us. I just messed somebody's theology up in the balcony. It ain't all on God. God said, I've given you everything you need to get to your next level of promotion. It's a two-way street. If you prayed about starting a business, where's the business plan? If you can't say amen, say ouch, man. You talking about you want to lose some weight? You need to lessen the portion of food and start exercising. It's a two-way street. So often we say, I'm waiting on a mighty move from God. When God says, I'm waiting on a mighty move from you. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Uno, dos. It's a dos. Somebody, oh, I got a little bilingual. Tres. No, this is not that tres. It's dos. Dos method. Two-way, two-fold method. Not only did he praise God, but he was persistent. And finally, his prayer was consumed with penitence, yes, sir. Which means repentance. It's right here in the text. Verse 6 says, I confess the sins. See that personal pronoun, I. Say I. Including, this is when it gets deeper. Including myself. Myself. And my father's family who have committed sin against you. Now if you notice, he didn't say, Lord, bless them for what those folk doing. Because you know when you point the finger at those folk, there's 3 points where back. So in order to get a new vision, you have to take responsibility for your own action. That's why the song says, it's me, oh Lord, standing. I'm glad y'all know that song. Nehemiah realized that in order to achieve the vision that God had for his people, he must first repent and ask for forgiveness of sins of the past. Nehemiah's task was to take ownership. This is where many of us, we stay in bondage because we don't take ownership for our own stuff. Yeah. It's always everybody else. If my daddy would have been there, if my mama would have been there, if the preacher would have did this, if the usher, it's everybody else's fault but own. Nehemiah says, it's right here in the text, y'all. He said, I want to confess I've fallen short of God. Sin means to miss the mark. It means we all fall short of God's glory. Sometimes we got to say, God, we've messed up. When was the last time you asked God to forgive you? When was the last time you repented before the Lord? It's difficult to experience new blessings in the future when you are still holding on to painful bondage and sins of the past. God can't do the new thing at St. Luke until we as a people repent. Repent means to do a 180, not a 360. No, you do a 180 and go. Some of y'all doing the same old thing and expecting different results. You can move, you can get a new job, but if your heart isn't changed, you're going to keep struggling and dealing with the same stuff. That's why David said in Psalms 51, create me a clean and renew a right spirit. Today, if we're going to experience and fulfill the great things that God has for the people of St. Luke and all of Dallas, we got to repent. Now, that ain't a church word. That's a real word. If we could do is do a 180, God would take our lives to another level. But I like what you said, Sister Washington. God needs to sprinkle some humility on us. A.W. Tozer says, it's not until you've been hurt deeply that God can use you greatly. In the midst of exercising prayer, praise, persistence and penitence. In order to get to a new vision, you must embrace God's providence. For those who are writing the final E's, I'm kind of an alliteration preacher that kind of keeps me focused because, you know, I told you about my tune, but I got my memory. E, you know, got embrace providence. Embrace providence. When Nehemiah prayed, he possessed inner resolve. Something was happening on the inside because he did a 180. And he got inner resolve, he got holy boldness, and I would say for the young people, he got some godly swagger. It says it in our text, verse 11, there's a temperature change. He says, give your servant success this day. Y'all see the shift? He went from repenting, now God sprinkled something in him, and he got some power. He said, grant your servant favor in the presence of this man. Do you hear the confidence in his voice? He not only knew who he was, but he knew that God had chosen him for that divine assignment. It wasn't an accident that this man who once possessed culinary skills would now lead a captivating movement that would help Israel get back to that place of prominence, prestige, and power. Well, Nehemiah realized that when God calls you to do something big, God will deposit new gifts and new abilities to perform the task. God would never call you to that new job without giving you the equipment to fulfill that task. God has God's name on you. Visionaries have this confidence, and they realize that there's more to them than meets the eye. People thought he was just a cupbearer, but not realizing God was using him as a catalyst to restore and to renew a community of broken people. He wasn't just a cupbearer, but God says, I'm going to use ordinary things for extraordinary purposes. And when I think about that so often, people often look at the outward appearance of a person, but I'm so glad God looks at the heart. God says, I'm going to take you, an ordinary person, and I'm going to perform extraordinary purposes. And people didn't think a one-term senator could be qualified to run for president. But Barack Obama said, don't judge me by the 322 days that I've been a senator. But what you fail to realize, there's a two-term president on the inside of me. When you are a person of vision, don't judge the outside of a person. Allow you and God to see the heart of inside a person. Nudge your neighbor, say there's more to him than meets the eye. It wasn't an accident or a coincidence that President Obama is the president of the United States of America. God doesn't operate by coincidence or accident, but God operates by providence. Say providence. You are not an accident. You are supposed to be here this morning. Say, I'm here. God doesn't make mistakes, St. Luke. You were supposed to come from Wichita. You were supposed to come from South Park. You were supposed to come from North Dallas to be at this place. God says, it's no mistake. You are here right now. But there must come a point in your life when you realize that where you are right now is not an accident. Say, I'm not an accident. Don't let others' opinions of you, your painful mistakes of your past, or even your present mishaps of the day, make you second guess where you are. That's good, preacher. We're supposed to be here. Say, I'm supposed to be here. Before you got in your mother's womb, God said, I'm going to predestine. I'm going to have you at St. Luke Church July 6th at 11:58. To position you to go to your new place of promise. If you know you're here for a purpose, give God some praise right now. Never. See, I've discovered in following Jesus, I never will allow my current position to hinder me from embracing God's providence. Now this is the point of the celebration when I realized that you got to let God just be God. And there's something about position, St. Luke. Many of y'all prayed when I came to be with my mother on February 1st, and as my mother battled cancer and I had to leave my immediate family, come back to my mother and be with her as she battled cancer. I didn't want to go because I knew what was waiting in Houston. But God says, Michael, if you just get out of the way and get in position, watch how I bless everything you touch. So I was in position, left Houston, come from Southwest Airlines. It hit the ground. I felt some peace. And when I got with my mother, her body and her mind continued to change. And my mom started smiling again. My mom said, I'm going to embrace life every day until the Lord calls my name. So I was in position from Ohio to Texas. And God says, because, boy, you have been faithful of your mother, I'm not only going to extend your mother's days, but I'm going to allow your mama to hear a phone call. February 14, 2014, St. Luke, this is not on the internet. This is my testimony. I'm sitting by my mama, not pastor, but I'm son. Because Jesus was a mama's boy, read the text. Couldn't find Joseph nowhere. That's a whole nother sermon. But I'm sitting by the bed, crying profusely, tears of joy, because I'm with my mother. And I get a phone call from Bishop Gregory Von Palmer. I say, hey, Doc, praying for you and your mother. How you holding up, Doc? I said, Bishop, I'm doing all right. Thank you for praying. I say, hey, doc, before you hang up, I got to want to share something with you. Now, you're one of my leaders in West Ohio, but there's a need that our connection needs to fulfill. He said, you ever heard of St. Luke Community Church? And so I hear that, but I'm an alpha man, so I'm cool, right? So alpha man, sometimes I'm doing the duck. So when he says St. Luke, you know, I'm just cool on top of water. I say, yes, Bishop. He said, well, Bishop McKee, more than all, if somebody could lead St. Luke's, I'm got the duck, I'm cool. He said, Doc, would you want to lead St. Luke? You ever seen a duck underwater? They cool. Right. Oh, but under the bottom, they just, when he said St. Luke, it was just moving, I was just cool. I said, Bishop, let me talk to my wife. I get back with you. I want to say, Bishop, hold, let me pray. Like, but I knew at that moment I was supposed to be here. Yeah. But the point is, it's not until you are in position that God can do great possibilities in and through your life. Some of y'all are out of position. But God says today is the day to get back in line again. There was a carpenter who saw the picture. In the beginning, he says, I know you got some problems. I know you got some pain, but I'm going to take your brokenness. I'm going to take your pain in the same way others try to throw it away. I'm going to put it back together and use you for a great purpose. God says, I'm going to take your mess. You ever had any mess before? Some of y'all wallowing in it now. He said, I'm going to take your mess and use it for a masterpiece. You ever been in trouble before? God said, I'm going to take your trouble and use it for triumph. For God said, have you ever? You ever been a victim? You ever been a victim? God said, I take your victimization and I use it to give you victory. But you got to be in position. Give God some praise there if you're ready to. I think Kenny Rogers said, you got to know when to hold them, Doc. You got to know when to fold them. So the doors of the church open. As you come, the chairs are coming out. Some of you all right now, God has read your email. He stepped on your big toe and your pinky toe. He said, how does he? I don't know. But God says, I knew you. And I formed you, and I created you for greatness. So today, as we celebrate, today if you need the relationship with Jesus Christ, relationship with Jesus, you want to reconnect, you've been on the sidelines, you know who you are, and God says, come on back home. And maybe you need a church home. I would love to be your pastor. You don't need a rental minister. You need somebody to call pastor. First Lady can pray. We're going to pray because God has a purpose for you. And God said, I'm going to open up the windows and pour out a blessing. Come on, as you clap your hands as they come. Come on, get back in line right now. Come on. Clap your hands like your life depended on it. We don't need no cute little prayer. Make your hands turn red. Clap your hands, because devil got to let them go. Today is the first day of the best days. Loose them and let them go right now. Come on, you need a church home. You've been chilling. Come on. This is your day. Maybe you want to get reconnected to St. Louis. You want to get reconnected. Come on, clap your hands. Don't worry about who's coming. God's looking at your heart. Don't worry about who's coming. Heaven knows who's coming. Come on, clap your hands as they come. I need my saints to pray right now, because there's a stronghold trying to hold you back. But God said, forget about the past. I'm doing a new thing right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You need prayer today. You need somebody to pray for you. Come on down right now. Come on. God knew you were supposed to. Come on. Clap your hands. I need us to expect like people are coming, y'all. This is the most exciting part of the celebration. When folks come back and say, here I am, Lord. Use me in spite of me. Balcony, we got time. Come on. That single mom, come on. God said, I hadn't forgot about you. Come on, this is your day, mother. Come on, young man. God said, I have a purpose and plan for your life. Clap your hands as they come. Come on, y'all. Come on, y'all. They coming. They coming, y'all. They're coming. Now, right now, just grab their hands. Somebody wants to come. Say, if you're nervous, I'll walk down the aisle with you. I'll walk down the aisle with you. This is your day. This is your day. This is your day. This is a moment. This is a defining moment, St. Luke. You can say, I remember Pastor Bowie's first Sunday, and I was with him when we transformed communities and we changed the world.
A fresh anointing.
Fresh anointing coming our way.
It's coming my way.
Yes, it is. A season of power.
It's a season of power.
Prosperity, healing, joy.
Prosperity.
You got to get your joy back. Some of y'all lost your joy.
It's a new season.
God said, come on, this is your day, sister. Come on, brother. This is your day. Come on.
It's a new season.
Come on,
Christ,
a new season,
it's a
baby.
New season. It's a new day.
It's a new
it's
day.
It's a new day. A fresh anointing. A fresh up. It's coming my way.
It's coming.
It's coming my way. It's
a season of power.
It's a season of power. And prosperity.
It's coming, St. Louis. It's coming.
It's a new season.
We
it's
haven't
a new
seen
season.
Anything yet.
Coming to me.
Our lives are going
to
be better than our former. The best is
it's
yet
a
to come.
Season.
A new
it's
season.
A new
come
it's
on,
a
brother.
New day.
I need a brother to come down here.
A fresh anointing.
I read your email. This is
it's
your day.
It's coming my way.
Coming your way.
It's a season,
a
of,
season
power.
Of power.
It's a season of power and prosperity.
Come on. Come on.
It's a new
come
season.
They're coming. Clap
coming
your hands, they come.
To me.
Say it one more time.
It's a new
season.
Season. It's a new season.
Come on, God's
a new
time.
Day. It's a new day.
God's having
a fresh anointing. It's coming
it's
my
day.
Way.
A season of
it's
power.
A season of power.
You need power.
And prosperity. And prosperity. It's a new season. It's a new season. Coming to me. Coming
yes, it is.
To me.
Yes, it is.
It's a new season. It's a new season.
A new
it's
day.
A new day. It's a new day. A fresh anointing.
This
it's
is
coming
your house.
My way. It's
oh gosh, I got a purpose
it's
plan,
a season of power. It's
come
a
on, they coming. Come on, they
prosperity.
Coming. They coming, y'all. I feel them.
It's a new season.
Sing with them.
It's a new season. Coming,
coming to me. One more then. One more
it's
then.
A new season. It's a new season. It's a new day.
A fresh anointing coming
it's
over
anointing.
This place.
It's coming my way.
They coming.
It's a season of power.
They coming. Gosh, I'm going to give you power to deal with every problem.
It's a new season, it's a new season coming for me.
Coming for me.
It's a new season.
A new day.
It's a new day. A fresh anointing.
The anointing is here right now.
It's coming my way.
God's gonna give us power.
It's a season of power.
Not for ourselves, but for God's glory.
And prosperity.
Now give God for praise for new season. Come on, give God some praise for the new. Come on, oh, that's weak, y'all. A new season starts today. It's a new season starting today. I know you got to get in the rose. It's a new season. God's presence is all over this room. God said, I'm going to do a new thing in your life. We need some more chairs. Do we need more chairs? If there's somebody else in the balcony, we don't like doing a drive-through because this is the most exciting time of your life. I remember when I said yes on this day, years ago. But God says, come on, I'm going to walk with you. Come on, sister. God says, I'm going to talk with you. Come on, y'all, clap their hands as they come. I just feel somebody else. This is not a root canal. I'm not pulling teeth. God says, I'm pulling that old stuff. You'll get a seat at Papa Doe's. You'll get a seat. Just right here. God is bringing folk here. This is a defining moment. This is a defining moment. I'm glad my sister's still clapping because somebody's about to come, y'all. Choir, just give me one strong clap as they come. Y'all think I'm crazy? They coming. Hey, y'all, they still coming. Come on, y'all. Ain't nobody mad but the devil. Come on, they still coming. Don't get tired. God didn't get tired on you. Come on, this is it. Fresh. Fresh. I want my young adults, so if you have a smartphone, I want you to tweet or post right now on your face. Say, it's a new season at St. Luke. Do it right now. Let folk know what's going on in St. Luke community. It's a new season, y'all. A fresh, ain't no stale stuff, fresh. Fresh. It's some of my freshness. What? Can we move forward now? Fresh, new season, power, 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 power. God's gonna give you power, 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 church. He's going to give us power to rebuild, power to restore, power to renew. Everything broke. God said, I'm going to put it back.
Good afternoon, St. Luke family and friends, Pastor Bowie, to Sister Bowie.